Hey everyone, a very good morning to all of you. Myself, Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs. So let's begin today's current affairs. Guys, before moving into the details of our first question, let me remind you that you can get the PDF of this session via the Telegram channel of ours. So guys, the very first question that we have here is, which country has been added into the Colombo Security Conclave? So here, the right answer is option E, Mauritius. So you must have heard about the Colombo Security Conclave many times in the news. What is it? Guys, it is basically a regional security grouping of countries which lie in the Indian Ocean region. Primarily, India, Maldives and Sri Lanka are the three main members of this grouping. And right now, Mauritius has been added into it. Plus, Bangladesh and Seychelles, both these countries have been given this opportunity to get the membership of this conclave. But remember that all these things happened during the 5th NSA level meeting that happened in Maldives. Okay, NSA stands for National Security Advisor. And India's NSA is Ajit Doval. Okay, and it was the 5th edition of this NSA level meeting where all these developments happened. So I hope that this much is clear. Let's have a look at the map as well. Guys, remember that maybe these locations might be here and there by a little inches because this is not the exact Google map, okay? But I chose this picture because it is very clearly showing you the countries in a line which will make it easier for you to memorize the countries and their locations. So here, guys, is Mauritius. Then here is Madagascar, Comoros, Seychelles, Maldives and Sri Lanka and India. So India, Sri Lanka, Maldives and Mauritius. Now all these four countries are members of the Colombo Security Conclave. Moving on to the next question. What is the theme of the third edition of the National Youth Parliament Festival? So guys, here option A, be the voice of New India and find solutions and contribute to the policy. So recently the third edition of this National Youth Parliament was organized. If you know the fact that this Youth Parliament system was organized for the first time in 2019 only, okay? Then in 2020, okay, which extended till 2021, and now the third edition of this Youth Parliament was organized. But guys, since your word youth is attached to this parliament, this event, you need to know the age limit. So the participants need to be within the age limit of 15 to 29 years in order to be eligible to participate in this National Youth Festival, and the third edition of this was held. Guys, do not forget the theme. Moving on to the third question, which state has announced a first of its kind child budget? So we had the union budget in February. Now guys, many states are releasing their budgets, and if you go through the daily current affairs provided by me, then you would understand that the government schemes particularly that have been released by the states, okay, are highlighted in the budget, and I put only those schemes in the documents because only that thing is important for you. Apart from this, if anything new happens in the budget, then also I provide it, like this child budget. Okay, so which state government is it? It is Madhya Pradesh. Now, as you would see, the schemes that were highlighted in the budget are here. Child budget we have discussed, that is the money allocated for the welfare of children in the state. Then we have Ladli Lakshmi scheme, which was not announced in the budget. It was already there in 2006. The purpose of this scheme was to encourage the girls to pursue their education and improve their social status. Okay, now the coverage of this scheme has been expanded to cover higher education. Okay. Next is Mukhyamantri Teerth Darshan Yojana. So many states are running similar kind of schemes, that provide the fees of pilgrimage for the old people who cannot afford the fees themselves. Okay, so same is the purpose of this scheme. CM Rise scheme. So the purpose of this is to open 360 schools across the state, and remember these schools will be equipped with state of the art technology, that means the modern technology. Chief Minister Fisheries scheme and cow welfare scheme. Guys, these two schemes were also highlighted, but nothing major was announced in these two schemes, but the allocations were there. Therefore, I haven't covered the schemes in detail, but remember that these two schemes are run by the Madhya Pradesh government. Cow welfare, to we all know, it is Madhya Pradesh, okay? Next question is, how much investment did India witness in digital shopping companies in 2021 as per London and Partners data? So guys, this is basically a London-based consultancy organization, and it has given data on the investments that were made in 2021 in digital shopping companies, okay? Like you have Amazon. Amazon is the mammoth in digital shopping space. So we are not particularly talking about that company, but including that also, like all the digital shopping companies, the investment in those companies were counted in this report. So according to this report, in India, $22 billion investments were seen. So now let's move into the details of this report. First, guys, the very first fact is that in 2020, the investments were $8 billion, and in 2021, it just increased by 175% to $22 billion, which is really, really a huge increment. Okay, this shows the potential of India in startups, plus the economic growth of India, plus the booming startup ecosystem of India. Okay, so all of these things are highlighted through this statement. Apart from this, guys, remember that now India has become the second largest global venture capital investment hub for digital shopping companies. Okay, so that is another fact from this report. Now, apart from this, India is the second. So which country is the first? It's US in terms of investment, with $15 billion of investments going into the digital commerce or shopping companies in US. Then China is third and UK is fourth. If we take the data according to the cities, then you would be amazed to know that India's Bangalore is at the first position in attracting the capital, venture capital investment in the digital shopping companies. So here, first position with $14 billion of investment. New York is at second, San Francisco is at third. Gurugram, again, an Indian city, is at the 7th position, and then we have Mumbai at the 10th position. Okay, if you don't remember these amounts, it is enough. Okay, it is good, but do not forget this amount, because guys, Bangalore is not only in India's first city, it is world's first, okay, at this moment. So please remember the investment that it has grown in the digital shopping companies. Guys, as per this report, 3 out of the 15 cities which have the highest count of unicorns are in India. Okay, so we have total 15 cities with highest number of unicorns, and out of these 15, 3 are in India. So which 3 are these? First is Bangalore, whose global ranking is number 6. Then we have Gurugram, and then we have Mumbai. Guys, please remember the number of unicorns that these cities have. Okay, this can also be asked. Now, the total global venture capital investment in 2021 stood at $140 billion. Okay, even if you don't remember this data, it is enough for your examination. This much is enough for your examination. $140 billion worth of investment was there, up from $68 billion. Okay, so this is a really good news, we can say. Okay, a good amount of investment was there. Now, guys, the next question is, what is India's rank in the Liberal Democracy Index in the Democracy Report 2022, Autocratization, Changing Nature? So, guys, first of all, this report is released by VDAM Institution or Institute, okay? So, according to this report, India's rank is 93rd, and you would be wondering to know that India is lagging behind 3 of the South Asian countries in this Liberal Democracy Index, whereas India claims to be the largest democracy of the world. So how come is this result in front of us? Let's discuss that. So first of all, I have already told you the organization releasing this report, but remember, VDAM is the institute under the University of Gothenburg in Sweden. Okay, so Sweden is the headquarters. Now, let's know the facts first, and then we will move on to the observations of this report. Okay, before moving into the facts, let me first straightforwardly tell you that according to this report, 70% of the world's population is living in the autocratic countries. Okay, so how is this fact here? Okay, is it really true? First of all, let me tell you, this is the fact given by this report. So yes, we are going to discuss that. But think, how is it that 70% of the world's population is living in the autocratic regime? Okay, till the time you come to your conclusion or I come to the fact, let's discuss the other facts that are there from this report. So 200 countries were assessed in this report, and remember that the report has divided the regimes, the kind of governments, into four parts. Okay, first we have liberal democracy, electoral autocracy, and closed autocracy. Okay, now apart from this, the other demarcation from this report is that this report has various sub indices within it. Okay, so the very first sub indices is this. The sub index is liberal democracy index, then we have electoral democracy index, and both of these indices are prepared on 71 indicators taken together. Then we have liberal component index. Now this index measures the importance of protecting individual and minority rights. Egalitarian component index, to measure the extent to which different social groups in a country are treated equally. Okay, egalitarian means to treat equal. Okay, next we have participatory component index, to measure the health of citizen groups and civil society organizations. Then deliberative component index, which measures the whether the political decisions are taken through public reasoning focused on common good or through emotional appeals, solidarity, attachments or coercion. Okay, so this part of the sub index measures this. Okay, so guys, here is the performance of the countries. First is Sweden. So here you can see different indices. So clearly there are six sub indices in this report. So according to the liberal democracy index, India stands at 93rd position. Okay, so if you remember the ranking of India in each of these sub index, then it would do wonders for you. Okay, because guys, here a lot of scores are given, so if you tend to forget the scores, then it would be fine, but please do not forget the rankings in each and every sub index. Okay, and please remember the ranking of this sub index, liberal democracy sub index. Now remember, Sweden, Denmark and Norway are the first, second and third positioned countries. Now in the South Asian region, in liberal democracy index, India is lagging behind Sri Lanka, which stands at 88th position, Nepal, which stands at 71st position, and Bhutan, which stands at 65th position. Okay, so these three countries are performing ahead of India and they are performing well in terms of liberal democracy, whereas Pakistan is behind us at 117th position. Now India, with the 93rd rank, is ranked in the bottom 50% of the countries if only LDI is concerned. Okay, liberal democracy index is concerned. So guys, rise of autocracies. So I had told you in the beginning of this report only, in the beginning of this question only, that 70% of the world's population is living in autocratic regimes. So what is it? So let me clarify first that 30 countries, okay, are the countries that are having closed autocracies, like you have North Korea. So that is a completely autocratic country. But 60 countries are the countries that are electoral autocracies. Okay, so basically the elected government is running like the autocratic government. So that is the meaning of electoral autocracy. So now, taken together, these 90 countries, 70% of the world's population is living under the autocratic regime. Now guys, apart from this, liberal democracies were on its rise in 2012, and now the number has declined at the moment when we are discussing this report, that is the 2021 report. 34 countries were having liberal democracies, okay, and this is, guys, the lowest level in the past 25 years. So clearly autocracy is on the rise at the moment. Okay, as per the classification, there are 89 democracies and 90 autocracies in the world. So guys, India is also considered as an elected autocracy because toxic polarization is on the rise in India as per this report. So do remember this fact as well. Now the last question of the day is, how much rooftop solar power capacity was installed in 2021 as per the rooftop solar market report, quarter four and annual 2021 report of the Mercom India? So here guys, 1.7 gigawatts is the right answer. So some days back we discussed the complete solar installed capacity. Now we are only talking about the rooftop solar capacity as per this report. So in 2021, 1.7 gigawatt of additional rooftop solar installation capacity was there. Okay, installations were there in 2021, in calendar year we are talking about. Okay, now the increment is 138% as compared to 2020, which is not a very significant percentage to remember. Next is, India has added 402 megawatt of rooftop solar in the fourth quarter of the calendar year of 2021. Since it is telling us about the fourth quarter's performance and the annual performance, therefore this is also significant. Moving ahead, at the end of the fourth quarter of 2021, the cumulative rooftop solar installations were over 7 gigawatt. Now guys, this is an important statement. Please remember this statement. Next is, Gujarat is leading the line of the states. Gujarat is the leading state for cumulative rooftop solar installations with 27% of the total rooftop installations in Gujarat. Next we have Maharashtra and Rajasthan following the footsteps of Gujarat. Next is that the top 10 states accounted for nearly 85% of the total rooftop solar installation. Now guys, this statement is indicating the inequality in rooftop solar installations, whereas only 10 states in India are accounting for 85% of total rooftop solar installations. Okay, therefore we need to expand this work in solar rooftop installations in other parts of the country as well. Okay, so here guys, today's video ends. I hope that you have enjoyed the video, and if there is any suggestion, feedback, confusion, anything, you can mention it in the comment section below. Thank you so much guys for watching this video.